Hello, hello. This video is the first of many videos on the IB Physics syllabus topic 4, oscillations and waves. This lesson, we are going to learn about oscillations. So first I'm going to ask you to give me some examples of oscillations. You have some examples on this slide. You can think about a lot of oscillations from your daily life where you observe oscillations. One example could be the motion of a metronome if you're a musician. You must have used one of these before. What we now call grandfather clock, that's not what grandfathers would call it, but that's somehow the name given to it now. Because it has a pendulum at the bottom. Bungee jumpers are in oscillation when they actually jump. So any system that works with springs, with pendulums, all musical instruments, and earthquakes are also oscillation examples. So how do we define an oscillation? At this point, I'm going to share two of these two videos with you. Of what is not an oscillation. So let's watch this first one. That looks similar, but is that an oscillation? What about this one? How are these two examples different from an oscillation? How do we define an oscillation in physics? How are these two examples different from what we define as oscillations, which are the examples on the previous slide? You can pause and think about that for a minute. Compare the motion of a bungee jumper, or basically any mass on a spring, the motion of a pendulum, or the motion of a metronome, and compare that to the motion of this bouncing ball that we just saw. So, if you have given it some thought, let's look at what they look like. Now, this is a screen recording I made from the website phet.colorado.edu. This is the website link if you're interested. I'm going to play this to show you, just for you to observe. Watch what happens to the force and the displacement vectors. How are they related? So on top in blue, you are shown the force vector. The green arrow is the displacement vector. This line is what we call the equilibrium point. That's where the spring is not pulled towards any side at all. So you see that the force is zero. And the displacement is zero from the equilibrium position, which we call the equilibrium position, x equals zero, in other words. So with that clamp, you apply a force in one direction, the spring pulls back. But as you pass to the other side, the spring this time will push back. So let's watch again. So I'm pulling to the right, and then I'm pulling to the left. When I pull to the right, the spring is pulling me to the left. When I move to the left of the equilibrium point, now the spring is pushing me to the right. So how are they related? Now this is an image of a motion of a spring in simple harmonic motion. This is to define a spring first. The motion of a spring, what we call an equilibrium position, that's where the spring is at rest. So it is not being pulled or pushed or stretched or squeezed by any external force. You can hang a mass, and the mass will obviously exert a force because of its weight. So it will pull the spring down. The spring will pull it back up. That is given as the spring force. It's in the negative direction of the force that is applied and proportional to the distance that is pulled through. The K is called the spring constant, which we define as Hooke's law. Now let's watch again and observe the values of the force and the displacement. This time you're going to watch the same thing, but I want you to watch the values of the force and the displacement. Okay, let's stop right there. 100 newtons towards the left when the displacement is 0.5 meters towards the right. Keep watching. 100 newtons force to the right by the spring when the displacement is to the left of equilibrium by 0.5. Do you see that the ratio of the force to the displacement from equilibrium is a constant? I can stop at any random point. If you look at the ratio of the force, which is 77 newtons here, to the displacement from equilibrium, which is 0.383, you will find that no matter which point you look at, that ratio is going to be constant, and that is what we call the spring constant. Feel free to pause and try at any point and see that that ratio does not actually change. So, Hooke's law is given by F equals minus kx. K is the spring constant. It represents how tough the spring is. So the tougher a spring is, the harder it is to stretch a certain amount of distance. That means it has a high spring constant. If the spring constant is a low value, that means it is more loose, which means for the same amount of extension, you would need less of a force because the ratio is small. If K is big, the same amount of displacement would require more force. So that would make it a tougher spring. That's the meaning of the spring constant. Its unit will obviously be unit of F divided by unit of X, which would be Newton per meter in SI units. So how do we define simple harmonic motion? If an object vibrates or oscillates back and forth over the same path, each cycle taking the same amount of time, the motion is called periodic. You have heard this word, period, time period, if you have done the spring oscillation lab, or if you have studied circular motion, or if you did the lab of the pendulum to calculate G. There is a point where the spring is neither stretched nor compressed. This is the equilibrium position. This is what I defined before. The rest position of the spring is called the equilibrium position. And the position of the mass attached to the spring is always measured starting from the equilibrium position. So in this picture, if the equilibrium position is this point, it's given here, and the mass is pulled to the right. Because it is on the right side of the equilibrium position, the displacement vector is going to point towards the right, where the force of the spring on the mass is pulling back towards the equilibrium position, which is to the left. You see these two vectors are in opposite direction. Let's keep going. The equilibrium position is here. If the mass passes the equilibrium position and is now squeezing the spring towards the left, always from the equilibrium position, the displacement vector is drawn. So this time it is pointing towards the left, where at that position, the force vector is pointing towards the right. Please observe that the force vector always points towards the equilibrium position. Okay, here are some terminology that you will need for understanding simple harmonic motion. Displacement is the good old displacement you probably have studied in mechanics and used in every physics context that you have ever studied. Displacement in this context, obviously SI unit is meters. It is measured from the equilibrium point. Amplitude is the name given to the maximum displacement. So amplitude is also a measure of length, a measure of distance. It's a name given to a particular displacement. So a displacement of a mass in simple harmonic motion can vary between a negative minimum and a positive negative maximum and a positive maximum, because it is going back and forth. the displacement at the equilibrium position is zero. The displacement at the maximum on one side is the negative amplitude. The maximum displacement on the positive side would be the positive amplitude. A time period is the time required to complete one cycle. Frequency is the number of cycles completed per second. Phase difference is the difference between two waves having the same frequency and reference to the same point in time. We will get back to this later in the unit, so I will just put a pin on this for now. Okay, back to another simulation now, again from phet.colorado.edu. This one is called Masses and Springs. This is actually going to be oscillating. So let's run so you see what's happening first. The yellow arrow is the acceleration arrow. The dotted line is the equilibrium point. Okay, what did you observe? Let's watch again. There. Oops. When the mass is at equilibrium position, the acceleration vector is zero. This line is starting to draw when the mass just passes the equilibrium point in one position, and it's going to show one period exactly. And please observe that the acceleration vector gets larger and larger as the mass moves away from the equilibrium position, but it always points towards the equilibrium position. Yes, so that is one time period. At the equilibrium position, the acceleration is zero. At the maximum displacement, you saw that the acceleration vector was maximum here and here. Okay, now we're ready to actually define simple harmonic motion. Think about the examples we looked at the very beginning of this video. I showed you some examples like bungee jumping or a metronome, which can be identified as oscillations, and a bouncing ball, which cannot be defined as oscillations. Although they might look similar in some ways, how are they actually different, and how do we identify a motion as harmonic motion? The first condition to be identified as harmonic motion is one, the force or the acceleration vector is always in the opposite direction of the displacement vector. We saw this in the video that we saw before. When the displacement is pointing up, meaning the mass is above the equilibrium position, you see that the acceleration vector is pointing down. As it passes the equilibrium position in the other direction, if the mass is over here, the displacement vector, which is always drawn from the equilibrium position, will now point down, and that's where the acceleration vector, which has to point towards the equilibrium position, will point upward. So you see that they are always in opposite directions. Let's see that again. And that is what I am talking about. And there we go again. Okay. The second point that is important to identify a motion as simple harmonic is that the force or acceleration vector is always proportional to the displacement vector. We saw this in Hooke's law. Hooke's law stated that F is equal to negative K times X. K is a constant. It's a ratio. The negative is a sign symbol of the direction. You obviously can see in Hooke's law that F is proportional to X. Well, F equals M times A from Newton's second law. So acceleration is also directly proportional to X, where X is the displacement from the equilibrium position. Well, if X is zero, it means it's at the equilibrium position. There's no force pulling towards the equilibrium position, which means the force or the acceleration will also be 0 when x equals 0. If the mass is at its amplitude, which is the maximum displacement from the equilibrium position, that's where the value of the acceleration and the force will also be a maximum, because it is furthest from the equilibrium position. It's dying to go back. It's the strongest force acting on the mass that is pulling towards the equilibrium position. So to recap, there are two conditions to define motion as simple harmonic. The force is always in the opposite direction of the displacement. The force is always proportional to the displacement. So it's always about the relationship between force and the displacement. Now I want you to think back about the bouncing ball and why that is not harmonic motion. Can you find a force that is always acting towards some equilibrium position? Not really. What is the force that is acting on a bouncing ball? If you ignore air friction, you can say the weight of the ball and the normal force from the surface of the table. And neither of those are restoring forces. They are there, one, because of the gravitational attraction on the ball of Earth, and the normal force is basically the reaction to the action on the table. Neither of them are pointing towards a certain equilibrium point. There is no equilibrium point. So that motion cannot be classified as a simple harmonic motion. And the eraser video that I showed you also cannot be classified, because that's just me pushing the eraser back and forth and not necessarily towards the equilibrium position. So that's not an oscillation either. Okay. If you plot acceleration versus x, which would be a versus x, x again, x being the displacement. Now, what did we say about their relationship? We said that one, they are proportional. And two, we said always in opposite direction, which means if you plot acceleration versus position, you have to have an origin-intercept negative linear graph, which looks exactly like this. If you look at the data booklet for physics, you're going to find this under topic 9 formulas. So I have this here just as a note for standard level physics students, just to let you know that this is available in topic 9, but topic 9 is not a requirement for you. The mathematical analysis of simple harmonic motion is not a requirement for standard level students, which is why this is the end of the lesson for this section of topic 4 for standard level students. Right, so here's the work as a follow-up for this lesson for standard level physics students. You have two tasks. One, derive an expression for the elastic potential energy using a sketch graph of F and X on a spring. Sketch a graph of force on the y-axis and X, the displacement on the x-axis for a spring. Imagine what it would look like. And then try to figure out what would you do with that graph to calculate energy. In other words, the work done. You're going to have to go back to topic 2, which is mechanics, figure out how to use that graph to calculate the energy, and then that's going to give you an expression in terms of the spring constant and the displacement in terms of elastic potential energy. And then once you do that, go to your workbook and answer the questions on page 165 and 166, also explained in my next video. Have a lovely day.